invade Kuwait, we broadcast a report in which the Secretary of Defense said that Saddam's retreat could be credited in large part to the Air Force's F-117 stealth fighter and the man who designed it, Ben Rich. Ben Rich's stealth fighter is a product of an arm of the Lockheed Corporation known by the improbable name Skunk Works. Skunk Works operated in the super-secret black world, a world of spies and deception that supplied the Pentagon and the CIA with aircraft that for 50 years have given us a technological edge over everyone else in the world, an edge which included the F-117 stealth fighter. And when it finally rolled off the assembly line, the stealth was in every sense of the word what its name implies, an airplane invisible to radar.
It looked like, you know, these airplanes that you made when you were kids and threw them? And it looked like one of those darts.
Did anyone look at this thing and say, that's not going to fly?
Kelly Johnson.
Kelly Johnson, the legendary airplane designer and founder of the Skunk Works, was Ben Rich's mentor.
And he saw this airplane, and he came up to me and he kicked me in the ass. And he said, are you crazy? You're going to make this thing fly? I said, Kelly, we have to make it fly.
In the mid-1970s, with his new design in hand, Ben Rich went to the Pentagon with his plan to build an airplane that would be invisible to the world's air defense, to radar.
The Pentagon must have thought that you were either a genius or you'd lost your mind.
Well, I went to see Bill Perry, who was then head of the DOD.
Department of Defense.
Department of Defense Research and Development. And I showed him the data. And Bill was enough of a scientist who had the foresight to say, hey, if this thing works and what you say is true, he says, we have made a tremendous breakthrough. I'm going to give you some money, and let's go on and build it.
That man who gave the okay, William Perry, is now the Secretary of Defense.
After a few hours meeting and seeing what he had there, I became convinced that not only was he on the track of something important, but it was on the track of a airplane design which would revolutionize air warfare. All of the world's air defense systems, there were hundreds of billions of dollars invested in these air defense systems, depend on radars for the early warning, for the detection, for the tracking. And when you have an airplane that cannot be detected by the radars, it just takes the heart out of the system.
Radar detects airplanes because it sends out a radio signal that bounces off the aircraft and picks up the signal on the rebound. The unusual shape of Ben Rich's stealth causes the signal to be deflected or absorbed by the airplane's special surface.
When someone's sitting at radar looking for what's coming in, and you've got an F-117 coming in, what do they see on the radar?
Nothing. They would see nothing. If an F-15 came in, they'd see a blob. An F-117 could overfly them and they'd never see us.
And they'd never see it on the
radar? Never see it on a radar screen.
So you're there before they can react.
Exactly. That's the whole secret.
And nearly everything the Skunk Works did was a secret. Named after a mythical place in the old comic strip Little Abner, Skunk Works wasn't hidden away in some remote corner. It was housed in this building in the middle of Burbank, California's municipal airport. Air travelers pass these buildings every day, never knowing that inside them was one of America's best-kept secrets.
We became equivalent to the Manhattan Project.
Which built the atomic bomb.
But tight security was something the Skunk Works was used to. Every project that they worked on, from building the high-flying U-2 spy plane back in the 1950s to the world's fastest airplane, the SR-71 Blackbird, was top secret. And Ben Rich lived in this world of secrets known as the Black World for 40 years.
How did you live a life? I mean, what did you tell your wife?
You could tell your wife nothing. She just told I was working on a secret program, and I'd go away for a week or two to our secret base, and we'd go do our job. And she'd never ask me questions.
What about when you traveled? Did you have to take any kind of special precautions?
Most of the time we traveled, we'd have to change our name, and I used a code name. My code name was Ben Dover.
Ben Dover.
Yeah. I mean, we had to add humor to the work we were doing because we were working so intensely.
Ben Rich writes in his recently published book, Skunk Works, that the F-117 was developed and built in the Skunk Works tradition, a tradition that includes a well-developed disdain for bureaucrats, even when one of them is an Air Force general.
Thank you very much.
Some general insisted that there was a military spec that the SR-71 had to say U.S. Air Force and the Stars and Bars. I said, General, I said, you're crazy. I said, you know, this has the temperature of an oven. Have you ever taken a piece of metal, paint it, and stick it under your broiler? You can't keep the paint on the metal. He says, no, the spec says you've got to say U.S. Air Force on our airplanes. I said, we'll develop it. So we spent $1 million developing a paint that could show red, white, and blue. And we put it on the airplane. I mean, it was just some stupid insisting on some spec.
Some stupid general.
And, yeah, I mean, who's going to see you at 90,000 feet? Who is going to see you at 90,000 feet that they had to see U.S. Air Force?
Despite the meddling bureaucrats, Ben Rich says the key to success was the Skunk Works' ability to cut through red tape.
For example, on the F-117, we had to get the guy climb into the cockpit. So I went to the local Builders Mart thing, bought one of these ladders for $50, and we just used it.
You didn't need to build
it. We didn't have to spend thousands of dollars designing it to a mil spec, military specification, and we did simple things like that. I'll give you another example. It was a Sunday afternoon, and we were assembling the airplane, and we found out we had forgotten to build the shield for the exhaust pipe. It was a steel cover. The foreman says, steel, where am I going to get steel Sunday afternoon? So he turned around and saw a shop cabinet. He told his assistant, he says, cut the shop cabinet up and let's make it out of that. So we cut the doors off the cabinet and built the shield. And we flew it in 2 days.
And where can you fly a strange new airplane in secret? Well, under cover of darkness, Ben Rich's plane was dismantled and then transported to the Air Force's top secret base at Groom Lake, Nevada. Air Force pilots Miles Pound and Barry Horn were among the first to test fly Ben Rich's revolutionary stealth fighter.
I can understand how they build a plane in secret, but how do you take pilots and you have to go out and fly this thing and test it?
Right.
How do you do that and still keep it secret?
Because they did it 150 miles away from Las Vegas, away from large populations out in the middle of the desert. And they cordoned off that area.
During the Cold War, Groom Lake was a prime target of Russian spy satellites, which took this secret photo, which today anyone can buy on the open market. So to keep the stealth fighter secret, they flew it at night at Groom Lake and at other secret Air Force bases.
The first 9 months that I spent flying the F-117, I never flew in the daylight. After we got checked out in the airplane, I spent the next 9 months flying only in darkness.
There are no lights on the base, and the guys become owls.
The pilots.
The pilots. And they become a completely different people. You have to learn how to live at night, to see at night. And they'd all, it would look like a vampire convention. They'd all try to get out of the sun before the sun came up. And then they'd not go out until the sun went down. And we made this strange thing that looked like from space, you know, like a diamond, Darth Vader type of a airplane fly.
But the true test of the stealth fighter was still to come. Would it work in combat? That test came a decade after it was first flown. January 1991, when Desert Storm began.
So when you are ready to go off into combat, the Desert Storm, were you confident with this plane?
I'd be dishonest with you if I didn't have a lot of apprehension. The first time you cross into enemy territory and you know that there are people up there trying to kill you, and it's their goal in life is to take you down, you certainly have a lot of apprehension.
Because they were going against what we knew to be the most lethal aerial threat that had ever been devised against an enemy, and we were their enemy.
Did any of those guys before the flights question whether or not the stealth technology
yes.
really worked?
In fact, just before they were going to launch, one of the guys turned to the commander and said, I hope this stealth, Ben Rich knows me once, I hope so, I hope this stealth shit works.
It worked.
It worked. It worked as good, if not better, than we expected.
All of their guns and all of the missiles were useless because they didn't know where to point. Now, they tried to shoot the airplane anyway. They just took the guns and missiles and fired them at empty space. hoping that an airplane would fly through them.
They didn't even come close. They didn't know what to fire. They just fired randomly. They knew they were being killed, and then we knocked out their eyes.
After the first couple of days of the war, when we kept coming back, and all of us kept coming back, and there wasn't a scratch on the airplane, for the first time in aerial combat, a crew member was able to concentrate solely on one thing in enemy territory, and that's the destruction of his target.
Combined with the latest in laser technology, Ben Rich's F-117s devastated Saddam's military command centers in Baghdad in a series of surgical strikes.
In the F-117, you say, I want to hit the bathroom. So he'll ask you, men's room or women's room? And you'll say, women's room. He says, tell me what window.
If someone said the target was the bathroom, and they would say, you want the bomb in the ladies' room or the men's
room? That's right. That is correct.
That's pretty good. This was a question of technology working. It wasn't a question of good luck for you and bad luck for them.
You're talking about breakthrough technology, and to have 43 nights in a row, to have all these fighters go downtown and come back without a scratch, kind of tells everybody in the world, not only our allies, but all the potential enemies that we might have, that, you know, the Americans just came up with something that is head and shoulders above anything we've seen before. Maybe we don't want to start a fight right now. I think Saddam found that out the hard way.
And just to make sure Saddam did not forget, the Secretary of Defense told us that he sent the F-117s to the Middle East when Saddam was threatening to invade Kuwait earlier this month.
We made a point of announcing that the F-117 was going to be among the forces that we were deploying there, because what we were trying to do was deter the invasion. And I believe we were successful in deterring the invasion, and I believe that the F-117 was a very important element in that deterrence.
I don't think that there is a single F-117 pilot that has ever flown that airplane in combat that has not at one time or another thanked God that Ben Rich had enough courage to go with his convictions. I think all of us, every single guy that flew in downtown Baghdad, owes his life to that kind of courage and to the people that built that airplane in this skunk works.
Shortly after we broadcast this story, the cancer that plagued Ben Rich finally caused his death. But if he is no longer with us, his genius is. Last month, the Pentagon unveiled Dark Star, a spy plane designed and built in part by Ben Rich's Skunk Works.